A big part of it is because our culture has made us so performance based and made us so that we compromise and made us so that we compare. And I think compare is probably the biggest problem. We compare ourselves among ourselves. And then competition. It's just three C's from hell: compromise, competition, and comparisons. And it's got people all frustrated. Listen, forget about what you think you need. Jesus gave you all that you have need of. And what he gave you more than anything else was the privilege and the ability to be able to love God with all your heart. And don't just sit back and be all silent and all, you know, I say this to people and everybody agrees with me. It is just it is a phenomenon. It is an unexplainable phenomenon. I say this and everybody everywhere just agrees, amen. But then they immediately go right back to their depressed state, their frustrated state, their shameful state, their inability to just be so excited about the Father. How hard is it? How hard is it when God in his own love reached all the way down and redeemed us from the snare of darkness and depression and death and sorrow and shame and fear, having liberated us, so that we can look like Crystal right now, having liberated us so that we can be the people, you know, I spent quite a bit of time interacting with Orthodox Jews, Orthodox Israel, just because of my, I just devoted to really getting the language of the Hebrew language down. And you know, their thing that they say all the time is that redemption hasn't come because the joy is not seen. Redemption hasn't come because the freedom and liberation that Messiah brings when he comes is not observed anywhere. So you can sit there and nod your head all you want, but that's what the witness has to say that comes to the courtroom. The witness comes to the courtroom and says, we don't see it. Thus, it hasn't happened. Because when Messiah comes, there will be great joy in the earth. There will be great freedom. The heart will be born again. The life will be made anew and be like him. This is true. Whether they're saying it's true, you can get it from Jeremiah. All I got to do is read Jeremiah. You can read the Psalms. You get it. They got it. They know what it looks like. Where is the light? The light is supposed to be shining in a dark place. And I want you to understand that you're going to have to give yourself to holy emotions. A.A. Allen, in the height of his ministry, and God used him in a great way, especially in the early days of his ministry, someone asked him, he said, and this is when great exploits, great power, demonstration of the Holy Ghost is taking place. They said to him, what would you say is the key characteristic to the moving of God in a person's life and in the midst of the church? And he said, unequivocally, joy and rejoicing. A complete detachment from everything that belongs to this natural existence, being caught away in the spirit. Today is the Lord's Day. We call it the Lord's Day. Some people think that, you know, we have a tradition. It was created somehow after Jesus died and rose from the dead. That is unique from what Jesus said and purpose, but it's not true, because the reality of it is Jesus rose from the dead on the first day of the week. And hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yom Rosh, it's the head of days, the first of days, the beginning of days, a new thing. And then when he was first seen by the disciples, it was also again, once again, on the first day of the week. This is the first day of the week here. Hallelujah. And then he was seen the second time, 8 days later, on the first day of the week, second time. And then Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, he said, for us to lay aside as we come together, the established coming together, as we, on the first day of the week, let us lay aside in our giving those things that the Lord has prospered us in and blessed us with. And we understand that the disciples, it's Acts 14 or 15, that they too that they broke bread having communion together on the first day of the week. And then, of course, John says in Revelation, where we connect that, John said something unique. He didn't say on Shabbos or Sabbath or Shabbat or Sabbath or many other different ways to pronounce it. He didn't say on Sabbath I was in the spirit and caught up into heaven. He said on the Lord's day. And if there's anything you want to learn how to do, is you want to learn how to keep the celebration. You know, it's terrible to invite people to come to a party and they come as wet blankets. It's terrible. You know, everybody's having a good time. The person walks in, they walk in like a cloud's over them, and all they want to do is talk about bad stuff, you know, about how this person did them wrong, and that person did that them wrong, and how things are going bad, and the devil's fighting them, and how they wish they had, and they can't have, and it's just not fair. We were all having a good time until you showed up. Now we got to try to break free of the oppression that you're bringing into our lives. You know, they don't know how to keep a party. They don't need how to keep a festival. Somebody said, well, one of the big problems today is that the church doesn't know what the celebrations are and what the feasts and the parties are supposed to be. They've lost track of it. They've got Christmas and Easter instead and Halloween. And they really get into Halloween. They fit Halloween. They fit it. And I say, no, not so. Not so. They just don't recognize it. Because Father has given us this celebration. Hallelujah. He's given us this resurrection celebration. Hallelujah. And you know, I'm so thankful that by and large, the United States of America, by and large, still recognizes this as a sacred day. And they recognize Saturday as well, for the most part. But really, Sunday and this day. And I don't like to go to restaurants because on this day, because that enforces somebody's got to go to work. I don't like to go to the store on this day because that enforces somebody's got to go to work. You know, I hate double standards. You know, I hate not thinking properly about things, really thinking things through. I believe that one of the things that people have a major problem with is they don't really think things through. They don't have a divine logic. Maybe they have an earthly logic, but they don't have a divine logic. They don't have a divine logic that says, wait a minute, because I've been liberated by God, that means I'm living in a joyous freedom. I'm living in a new life, a new realm, a new adventure. And then he comes along and says, well, I've given you abundant life. And then he's now all of a sudden, I read over the 570 times, over 570 times that he talked about joy and rejoicing, and realize that now that has come into place in my life. That is a living reality. And then I read how it's become a wellspring on the inside of me. And it's an artesian well. I'll tell you right now, there's the worst thing that you could possibly do is go turn on the water and it doesn't come out. Is that disappointing or what? Couple of you know that. The rest of you, I mean, come on, celebrate a little bit. Celebrate a little bit. I know you're taxed. I know you're taxed. I know you're oppressed. But we'll get you liberated, and we hope you stay free. I understand the problem. Believe me, I do, because I read about it in the Word. It's not my own perception. I understand the right from the wrong. I understand what it means to be able to give yourself to the Word of God, which becomes a tree of life to you. I understand what it means to give yourself to righteousness, which becomes a tree of life to you. I understand what it means to give yourself to speaking good things, because your tongue becomes a tree of life to you. I understand that the river of God and where His river flows, I mean, it's not just one tree of life. On both sides of the river grows groves, orchards, I mean, a forest of the trees of life. It's the trees of life. And bear 12 manner of fruit all year long. 12 manner. What kind of fruit we're going to get this month? Because it's like every month. And 12 manner, 12 different times. Wow. Wow. And the leaves. Whoa. Somebody said it's just all symbolic. I don't believe so. I believe the Lord's going to allow me to write a book. And I said it was going to be a semi-fictional, but it doesn't have to be. It's going to be a book on living with Jesus for 1,000 years about how people, with the food that you eat, you just have yourself a couple of leaves. Hallelujah. It's the healing of the nations. Just have yourself a couple of leaves. Well, see, I already got that. I already have that. It's already happened to me. I'm not waiting. I'm trying to get convince somebody of the good news. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to be transparent with you. I get enormously frustrated. Not at anything else in my life, but God's people. That's it. You find me anywhere else in any context in life, and I'm really doing well. I'm just happy. I've got no issues. I've got no problems. I'm just doing it. I'm just loving it. But get me in front of a bunch of sour-pussed Christians. Get me in front of a bunch of people who say they know God but have no evidence, no fruit. There is no manner of fruit upon them. There is no manner of fruit upon them. Supposedly they come and they received the life. I'm telling you right now, what I have in Christ Jesus, a tree can't give me. I have in Christ Jesus what a tree could not give me. Hallelujah. 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 One day I'm going to eat of the tree of life. I will eat of the tree of life because he said so. So you overcome, I'll give you the right to eat of the tree of life. And I don't understand all of that. I believe that there is some symbolism there. But it's always something literal first. Can you imagine being in a situation where you can hear the flowers sing? Suddenly everything becomes living. You can even hear the voice of the rocks where they cry out. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, we think we understand it all. We think we know it all. But you know it all, you know, people. Because we got our little science classes. We do our little experiments. And I said experiment purposely that way. And we think we just got it. No. Ha, ha, ha. No. Right now, if your eyes were open, you would see a whole nother realm. A whole nother realm. The real realm, the realm that is eternal. But bottom line of it is, there's no reason for you not to have your eyes open. Why should we talk all our life to people about being able to see? You know, come on. And somebody said, well, I want that and I'm just so frustrated. Well, if you just start getting unfrustrated, you could have some. If you just start learning how to worship, if you would start learning how to praise, if you just begin to take what God has given and begin to love him with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. Come on, think about that. With all of my mind, with all of my soul is being. It's your whole being. It's every part of your being. I want to, but I don't know how to. Well, the Holy Spirit has got the remedy. You call upon the name of Jesus Christ. He brings the cure. Hallelujah. He brings forth a new creation. Today, you can become a new creation. You can become a new creature. Redemption can come into your life because I've got good news for the bad view of the Haredim or the Orthodox Jews. I'm your huckleberry. You haven't seen it, then you haven't met me yet. Let's get together. I'll show you redemption. I'll show you salvation. I'll show you freedom. I'll show you liberation. I'll show you the sons of God. I'll show you the resurrection. I'll present Jesus to you. Somebody said, how did you get that? I got that because I started agreeing with God. I just said it. Because God said it, and I started saying it, and I got to say, and in the midst of saying it, I got so happy about it. I started dancing around going, woo! Yeah! And then I didn't stop. And it just, you know, listen. Yeah, it should be every day. It needs to be. But there is one time above all other times that it needs to be. And that is now. Because you're bringing your best. That's what I see. I see that is it. You are really, truly bringing your best. Because now there's no lies here. Now there's no pretend. Because this is the house of truth. This is the spirit of truth. What you really know and what you really have is what you present. And God's giving you an opportunity to have more. And you've just got to learn how to worship Him. See, Father, hallelujah. Papa God, hallelujah. The Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He just so earnest and so hungry, seeking. He's seeking. In other words, He's looking for some group to hang out with. He's looking for somebody to be with. He's looking for somebody who gets it. And what He's seeking is those who will worship Him. Those who will worship, who will be excited about His life. Excited about the one who originated life, who created the beginning. He created the beginning. He created the beginning. You know, when He made me a living soul, He made my soul pure. Adam became, by God's wonderful love, a living being. And Jesus stepped in because of Adam's rebellion and sin that passed upon all men without any choice. And He gave all those men that had no choice in it an opportunity to choose. Gave them the opportunity to choose life and live. Not any kind of live, life to live. A life that is abundant life. A life that is a wellspring. Don't get bogged down. Don't get frustrated. Stop it. Satan's playing games with you and you're listening to him. You don't have a clue. Stop it. Shut him down. Grab a hold of the wonderful love of God and begin to thank Him and begin to worship Him. And let the Holy Spirit will put a smile, create a smile that you can't stop. He'll give you inspiration that you can't withhold. Oh, He will. I'm glad there's got one amen. Amen, 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 amen. He's given. Hallelujah. When I didn't deserve it nor have any reason to, of my own self, to be able to prove it, I walked around singing, I'm the apple of your eye and you love me. Oh, and because it's reality, it's true. And it birthed within my heart a wellspring. It birthed within my heart a wellspring. Hallelujah. Calling upon the name of Jesus and recognizing the love that God has for me. I told the Father the other day, I said, Lord, I'll do it. I'll do it. I'll continue to do it. Even though all your people should begin to be overwhelmed. You should actually be overwhelmed by the Holy Ghost as you hear what I'm saying. And even though the people don't, even though they still don't know how to get it because they're still locked down in a place of withholding from God. I'm going to keep doing it. I'm going to keep doing it because one day, somewhere, somehow, some way, it's going to happen. And oh, what a blessing it's going to be to the Father. He's blessed over when just one or two people out of 10 million get it. One or two out of 10 million. What He's made available for everyone. And I'm going to tell you why people don't get it. They're bogged down with the cares of this life, deceitfulness of riches, pleasures of this world. They're bogged down. They're entangled with the affairs of this life. They're bogged down in the realms of competition, comparisons, and compromise. They're bogged down and frustrated because they don't have something that they don't even know what they want. Have you ever been in this situation with someone? A child. Screaming its head off. They're screaming their head off. Why are you crying? They don't know. They want something they don't know. They're just unhappy. They're frustrated. Maybe filled diaper, hungry, just whatever. Who knows? Huh? If it's that, it's simple. You remedy that. You go through the checklist. You know, when they're screaming, you go through the checklist. And after you're done with the checklist, they're still screaming their head off. You're going, what? They don't know what they want. They're just empty inside. They're just needy. You're just frustrated. Something bad's going on. Will you let Jesus come and touch you today? Will you let Him save you? Yes. Will you let Him save you from your frustration and your fears? Yes. Because fear is bondage. Papa wants to liberate you. He wants to liberate you into a joy that you don't have to pretend. You can see my eyes are smiling with my face. You know, you see somebody smiling and they're not happy, looks like a clown.
because they get a smile on their face, but their eyes are sad. That's perfect clown material. It's true. That's what they do in their makeup thing. Right? There's all of these conflicting themes going on simultaneously. The Lord wants to bring life into your heart, joy into your heart.
Hallelujah.
Many people walk away from the life and the joy. They don't agree. And one time somebody came to me and they said, "You do not offer any room for our valley experiences." I said, "Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, would you please live it?" Well, I just disagree. I believe that there is times where we need to be afflicted and mourn. And then he just pulls out a couple of verses of scripture to try to support his argument. Listen, man, if you're going to have faith to be afflicted and mourn, go on with it. I'm not arguing. If you're going to try to argue, just stay in your depression and sorrow. I mean, because, when people say that, it's not a season. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. And they're just trying to defend their lifestyle. You can be seated. Just quit being seated. Isn't God so glorious? Look what Jesus did for us. He made a new creation, brought forth a new beginning. Hallelujah. Jesus stepped in and became the reviving spirit. And you're not going to be revived. No person, no man, Jew, Gentile, the nations of the earth, you will not be revived until you meet Jesus. When you meet Jesus, he revives you. And that's revive is resurrection. He revives you. He resuscitates. It's a synonym. He resuscitates. He brings life again. He restores life again. Salvation is where you and I are washed with the water of regeneration, and we revived, we renewed, we resuscitated, we recreated by the Holy Ghost. That's what Paul said. That's what Paul said, Titus 3:5. People say, "I disagree with you." You disagree with me based upon your philosophy and your ideology. You know, there's three kinds of people. A lot of people disagree about the things of the Bible. I mean, everybody's arguing. I'm just not going to argue. They start arguing, I'm going to go rejoice. And anybody wants to come rejoice, come rejoice. Let the arguers argue. There's three kinds of people. There's the people who believe that God's word is absolutely his word. And everything that Jesus said is for us right now. And it's what God demands of our life. And what he demands are things like, glorify me in your body and your spirit. Be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. Wow. Give me a break. This is the commandments. And this is amazing. Live my life. Have abundant life. Have rivers flowing. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost. I mean, these wonderful things, you know. Live in joy and love and goodness. Wow. Be holy like I am holy. Woo! See, that's coming out of me. I'm not pretending. I'm not giving some kind of little show for you. You know, listen, really, there are people that are around you are asking the question, what makes you different from any other religious person? What makes your meeting so special, so unique from any other meetings? You have to ask yourself, do you have something in your life that only God the Holy Ghost brings, and it truly is the description that he described? Oh, my tongue is as the pen of a ready writer. My tongue is his quill. The Holy Spirit is the ink. Today, right now, he writes the pages. He writes the pages of his will. He writes the pages of his life. He writes the pages of his love. Written upon the tables of our heart and expressed upon our face. Do you want that? It's a gift. It is a gift, but you can't be, if you're wanting other things, those other things are going to conflict you. Those other things are going to cause the well to be stopped up, so to speak. They're going to cause the a disconnect between that which Father has supplied, which cannot be polluted and it can't be integrated with any other thing. You've got to say, look, I'm going to separate myself. People talk about sanctification. You got to understand, God is calling us to separate ourselves to living in a relationship with Him where there's no darkness in it, where there's no sorrow in it, where there's no fighting and fussing in it, where there's no sadness and depression in it. Somebody said, oh, I would do that if it wasn't for my spouse. Oh, I would do that if it wasn't for my aggravating children. You know, it's like one person said, you know, all you young adults, you need to be more grateful towards your parents that they didn't kill you when you were a teenager. Quit talking bad about them, because that's about the turmoil that goes on in a lot of people's lives. Sad. The Lord has come to give us life and to give it to us abundantly, to give it to us supernaturally. Life. What you would describe as life. Life is a good time. Life is the big vacation, and it's free. Huh? And it was a happy time the whole time. There was no robbers. Huh? There's no wobbers. Where's Ruthie and a wobbers? Are there going to be any wobbers? There's no robbers. Oh, mama sikia lana mataya. Come on, man. If you start to lose your joy, you're supposed to run back to Him.
Right.
But what happens if all week you just given yourself to depression? You just given yourself to frustration, giving yourself to doubt and unbelief. What's wrong with me? The what's wrong with me thing. Because you're comparing yourself to someone else and you want to be better than them. Or you feel left out because you didn't get something you thought you needed to have. Because this is what goes on when He's your whole heart. And He's like, you got me, what else you want? And that's where it's got to begin, because a lot of people are not willing to begin. They want to have all these other things that Father describes as the overflow, but they're not willing to begin in the right place of relationship with Him, where we just love Him with all of our heart and we love Him with all of our soul, all of our being. We love Him with all of our mind, and it shows, and out of that love we obey Him, and out of that love we just joy His presence, we just desperate for His presence, we hungry for more. But I'm always hungry in a faith realm. I'm never hungry in a doubt and unbelief realm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm hungry as a child is towards a father. I know I'm going to get fed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's terrible to be hungry and there's no, and, you know, and you don't think you're going to get fed. Or you're uncertain. That's an orphan for sure.
Yeah.
Papa's not left us as orphans.
No.
I'm in Dad's house.
Yes.
I'm in Papa's house.
Yes.
I have everything supplied to me according to His riches and glory. And all I really am, and I'm just so excited about, I'm so excited about the relationship. I don't care about nothing else. And then I look around and see what all God's done. And I go, wow, that is amazing. But you're the best. I just love your presence. I don't have to yearn, wait, and hope for His presence. I'm filled with Him. Filled with Him. I'm filled. I don't just demarcate His presence and the manifest presence just based upon one emotion or one feeling or one sign or one expression. For He feels all of life, and all of life, true life, expresses who He is. Whew. I mean, sometimes God put the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon me in prayer, intercessory prayer, urgent prayer. And that's radical. That's intense. Huh? You think that things are flying around. Huh? I mean, it's just like a gone to war kind of thing. Huh? It's Papa. It's God the Holy Ghost. My tongue is as the pen of a ready writer. My tongue is His quill. And the ink is the Holy Spirit. And He writes the pages of His will. Hallelujah. With it. But I've got to be willing to be a part of it. He writes the pages of His life, showing what it is. Showing what it is He wants and what it is His purpose and what it is it looks, what it really looks like. What, you want a bigger house, you want a smaller house, you want a big newer car, you want an older car? What is it you want? What, you gotta have this and that, and you gotta have, Lord, I'll take you, but I want to look at the benefits package first. And a lot of people are there. They're like, oh, Lord, I take you, but I'm still like, you know, I'll hold off for the response because I'm still reviewing the benefits package. Because it's like some things here I'm not in agreement with, and I really don't see how this is working out on my behalf. I'm describing what's going on within the framework of the church, why so few people are captivated and caught away in a river of joy, in a river of divine love. God came to free us to be able to love Him. He poured His love in us by the Holy Ghost to live a life that is like, woo, I don't care about nothing. I don't care about anything but Him. I'm so captivated by Him, I don't care about food, I don't care about clothing, I don't care about who, whether I have any friends or not. I got Him. Yeah, three amens, two chuckles, and everybody else is staring at me because you don't get it. I understand. But that's the state of the church. The reality of it is, God wants to write the pages of His will upon your life, but you have to yield your members to Him. You have to just say, okay, wait a minute. I'm going to go with you, God, because when did the one tell you, 1 second after you're dead, it's all about Him. Or it's not. To be cut off from God and be cut off from life and be cut off from the land of the living where there is no praise, where there is no knowledge of God. Did you know that's another dimension of hell? There's no knowledge of God. There's no knowledge of life. There's no knowledge of anything. But that hell, but that sorrow, but that death, but that shame. God made Adam a living being, shaped in His image and His likeness. In the garden of His plenty, in the garden of His paradise, with fellowship and relationship with Him. And it wasn't very long, and He was willing to succumb, to be overwhelmed by a lie, to give Himself over to disobedience, to second guess God, to question whether or not the relationship was really what He wanted. And He led all humanity into darkness that day. Father, not willing for men to perish, not willing for men to stay in a darkness and a sin and iniquity that they individually did not choose. Although man went on to choose, the majority of all men went on to choose sin and iniquity. There were some exceptions. Did you know that? There were some exceptions. The Lord looked, and I believe it's Psalms 51 or 52, He said, I looked and I saw no man. No, there was no one. 51. None did righteousness. But you know what? Before that, there were those who did. Enoch did. Enoch walked with God and pleased Him. That means he walked in the realms of the Spirit. That means he walked in the realms of faith. Because I understand that's what's essential to please Him. Job did. Job took a hold of God. But that's like two people out of billions of folks. You know, we were born messed up. Did you know that?
Yes.
I know that's hard for some people to believe. But you get closer to Him and you'll see how messed up you were when you were born. We were born messed up. We were born twisted. We weren't born righteous. We were born everything unrighteous. God in His love came, gave us a gift of righteousness so we could learn how to be right. So we could be whole, so we could live out this life. And it just, people are stuck in religion. I look and I'm amazed when people talk, sometimes people talk the most about it or stuck the most. Now they got to really work hard not to be religious, so they wear shorts and t-shirts to church. Try not to be religious. Huh? They go and act like the world, try not to be religious. What a crazy, crazy notion. Then you have the other spectrum. But by and large, what's in common is everybody's sitting all in bondage to fear and to death and to sorrow and to shame, all worried and all concerned about their life and about tomorrow. Instead of just walking around, living out this wonderful abundance in God. Father would like to bring you today to where that you don't have any more needs. He would like to bring you today to a place where all of your needs are supplied. Hallelujah, all of them. He would like to bring you to a place to where all of your needs are supplied to you today by Christ Jesus according to His riches and glory. God would like to bring you to a day today to a place where He can lead you in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. You can find yourself seated at a table that He has prepared. You can find yourself having this relationship with one who leads you by still waters and in green pastures, where you can say, the Lord is my shepherd and I have no more needs. Everything I desire, I find in Him. And I got Him, and nothing can separate me from this love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I'm not interested in anything. I'm not interested in the TV serial. Days of your death. As the world curls or whatever it is. As the world churns. As one person said, as the world upchucks, trying to keep it mild. People are trapped in that. People are trapped in that. They're trapped in it. Oh, I gotta get my cereal. What's gonna happen tonight? It's a fantasy. It's a lie. You're living a vicarious existence. Did you know that? It's a realm for demonic powers to access you. At least they've got an excuse. Then you got the holiness people who don't watch TV, and they're worse off than the people that do. They're worse off. They're more miserable than anybody. They're miserable. The agony of their life, the groanings of their life. They're walking around trying to be something that they don't have the power to be, because they're doing it out of their self, and just talk about how that they don't have a TV and how that they wear their hair a certain way and don't have jewelry and all the crazy things. It just goes on and on and on and on. God's called us to come and live. Amen. Father's called us to come and live.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Today, the invitation is extended to you. When you step into this life, you can't stop the joy.
Amen.
It's hard to put the frown down. Where it's been hard to put the frown down, now it's hard to put the smile down. It's hard to, you can't, it's a wellspring.
Yes.
You don't have to work for a wellspring. That's a well. Pump. Wellspring just flows. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. And I'm telling you this because the Lord is inviting you to come out of whatever you're in. Yeah, I believe that people truly, genuinely get born again. But they get stuck. They truly genuinely get born again, but they get stuck. They don't go on. They're just stuck. They never come into the joy. They never come into the love. They never come into the rest. Because when you're at rest, you're full of joy. When you come into the peace, it's just good. Do you have any money in the bank? No. Do you have any food in your refrigerator? No. Do you have any hope of getting any? My Father, who feeds the bears and the birds and the bees, who clothes the trees and the fields, He provides all that I have need of. Because all those things really, I forgot a very important one. Do you have any friends? No. Because all those things are values. Do you have anybody who likes you? Do you have anybody who's praised you lately? Do you have anybody who said, that's a good job? No. But all those things are meaningless, really, when your heart has been captivated by what's really going on. It's meaningless. When you step into a relationship with Him, suddenly you understand why people act the way they do, why they look the way they do, why they frown all the time, why they aggravated, why they always speaking evil, even of their mother's son. Huh? Just to use the way the psalmist described it. Because there's no end to the complaint and the murmur and the accusation. Oh, what a demonic realm. Paul wants you to bring you into a blessing.
Yes. Amen.
He wants you to free. He wants to free you to love people when they hate you.
Yes.
He wants to free you so you can be happy and confident when there's no other earthly position, that your heart is not attached to all these things anymore. Now you're liberated to be fully empowered by God and fully bankrolled by the Almighty. Somebody told me, they said, how are you financing all this? God, no, really. No, really. How does that work? Because I worship Him.
Amen.
When I get bad news, I worship. Because
yep.
I don't want that bad news to touch my heart. I keep my heart with all diligence because out of it, the issues of life flow.
Yes.
When everybody says, you're not going to make it, I worship. When there's some kind of an accusation that I don't have what I'm supposed to have, I worship. Because I have the most important thing that Father's looking for, and when He sees it, I promise you He's going to be there. I promise you He's going to be manifested. He seeks for men to worship Him, spirit and truth. And I want you to open your Bibles and just quickly read this to you. And I just want to say this to everybody who's made their car a taxi cab to heaven, has gone and just taking care of people. Bless you. That is the work of the ministry. When you start caring for the poor, you on Papa's side. You get His attention. When you start taking care of children, when you start becoming a parent to them, loving them alongside of their parents, I'm telling you, you've got Father's attention. That's what He calls righteousness. Thank you so much. I was just so blessed to look at the tables out there. And, you know, I walked up to the 3 to 5 year old and I said, is this where I sign up? You know, they look like they have lots of fun. The glory train, you know. Hallelujah. I'm going to have fun. I'm going to enjoy myself. I don't have to have money to have fun. Huh? Come on. I don't have to have all this stuff to have fun. I don't have to have to be some kind of special group of people. I said, oh, you know, everybody's got their reasons of why I can be happy and they're not happy. Now, there's only one legit reason. I have Jesus. I'm allowing God, the Holy Ghost, to write the pages. I'm a living epistle, written of God and read of men. He's written these things upon my heart. He displays them on my face. I want to live great for Him. I want to do great deeds for Him. But I don't need to. For it's His desire and it's His will and only He can make that happen. I'm not going to go do it myself. I'm just going to worship. I'm going to glorify Him in my body and my spirit, which are His. I'm going to live in divine health. I'm going to keep my... You know, I'm just so blessed because I go different places and I'm with different preachers and then all of a sudden we're with them a day and then I got to lose weight and get in shape because, you know, Ann and I, we go take off running. They're going, what? You guys, we were in a place not too long ago. They said, it's too hot out there and you'll collapse. Do you have your phone to dial 911? They were concerned. I said, no, no, no. I said, no, we do this. This is fine. They were like worried. They were just like, but it's really very hot here. I said, here, it's like, it's different from where we're from. Where we're from, you get dehydrated, don't know it. When you're out here, you take a shower the whole time you're doing it. It's just so wet. You know, we go run for 3 miles and come back, and they're looking at us like, you're still alive? How do you feel? We're doing great. And all of a sudden, hey, well, I got to get fit too. That's good. You need to take care of yourself.
Yes.
It's good we can be examples to people what it means to be healthy.
Amen.
I care about the temple.
Me too.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody said, well, we can't afford to get organic bread. Pray over your white bread. Pray over your bleached white bread. Hallelujah. Got to take care of it. Besides that, I'm going to tell you right now, you go get food cheaper at farmers markets anyways. Huh? Praise the name of Jesus for it. Hey? Come on. Come on, people. Quit listening to the lies. Being a part of all the stuff that just takes away from you being able to glorify God in your body and your spirit. But the bottom line of it is there is no expression like that other than worship. I got some fat friends who are very, very anointed. Fat. They're all trying on lose weight programs. They're really anointed. But they know how to worship. They know how to move that fatness. They're all over the map. They go this way and their body goes that way. I mean, you know. Come on. I love you guys. Hallelujah. Because that's a show of health that goes beyond any other. Woo. I'm glad they're not sitting around depressed about their state. I had a subversive day the other day. So I'm so depressed with myself. I'm so depressed at my food choices and he's going on and on and on. I said, you just worship. Just worship. You're so bogged down in what you can't do and all your failures and all your lack of discipline, all your messed up, dysfunctional self. Well, that's not really what I wanted to hear. Worship. I didn't call you to worship. I didn't call you. You called me. You called to hear. And what, you want me to come and say something that is going to tickle your ears? I'm not a tickle-ear preacher. I'm not a tickle-your-ear preacher. I'm not a tickle-your fancy. I'm not a say what you expected me to say preacher. I'm going to tell you, worship, man. Make it about Jesus. Make it about the Lord. Make your life about Him. When all this stuff is coming in, when all these thoughts are assailing you, when all these things contrary to what He's done for you are trying to take hold of you in your thoughts, rise up and worship. Amen. You got to let God arise. You got to let God, and then all of a sudden your enemies will be scattered. You're going to have to be willing to submit yourself to Him. Then the devil will flee. Amen. You ain't going to submit yourself to Him until you learn how to worship. Amen. You learn how to praise Him. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
One of the things that I do, just because of the way that I'm giving myself to learning more thoroughly the language of Hebrew, is I recite and read all the prayers, and you know, prayers for resurrection, prayers for rejoicing, prayers for ascension, you know, in the morning. And it's just all you're going to hear is over again. Let my soul rejoice, let my soul rejoice, let my soul rejoice. Let my soul delight, let my soul delight, let my soul delight. Let me be a full of praise. Let me be filled with thanksgiving for all that you've done. Oh, bless the Lord. Oh, bless. It's just such a all and on. Of course, there's a lot more things to say that are identified. Everything is identified from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, from the stars to the blades of grass upon the earth. But nonetheless, it's always with joy. It's always with thanksgiving. It's always with delight. And they can't really do that because they don't have that. They don't have the Holy Ghost. But I can.
Yes.
And all they're doing is they're taking every little dimension of verses of Scripture that talk about delight and thanksgiving and joy, and they're just concentrating it into the prayer, into the thanksgiving. Oh, that life would be lived by you this day, that you would take a hold of beginning to be a follower of Jesus. To be a follower of Jesus, you're going to walk in righteousness. To be a follower of Jesus, you're going to be anointed with the oil of joy, which is a synonym or another way to say Holy Ghost. Because we know how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, but we understand that He anointed Him with the oil of joy. Same anointing, same person. We're talking about the same Spirit. Oh, come on. To delight to do Thy will, O Lord. See, it's going to begin with the expressions of my mouth. Lord, my tongue is the pen of a ready writer, a willing scribe, an anxious note taker. I'm ready to hear your words. Huh? You're in that most important meeting and you got your pen out. Huh? And you got your note-taking tablet out, and you're ready to get the insights that's going to make all the difference in your life. You're ready to hear it. Boy, you're just ready. You're right at that start gate. I hope you're not going to miss a single word, right? My tongue is as the pen of a ready writer. My tongue, oh God, is your quill. That's my expressions of His word. I begin to praise Him with His word. I begin to praise Him in response to His word, saying, thank you that I am your habitation. Thank you, oh God, that you have this inheritance in me. Thank you that you blessed me with all blessings in spiritual places. Thank you, oh God, in heavenly realms. Thank you, oh God, that you have put within me this wellspring of life, this river of joy, this river of love, this glorious peace, this goodness, this abundance, that you my protector, that you my provider, that you, oh God, are the one who perfects everything that concerns me, that I'm good in every way and holy and acceptable in every way with you. Wow. There is no shame there. There is no condemnation there. There is no sense of failure there. I have no sense of failure. When I was walking around with blue jeans with holes in them and flip-flops and t-shirt and long hair, I had no sense of failure. When I spent more time surfing than praying, I had no sense of failure. Listen to me.
Yes.
I had none. I was captivated. I was liberated to worship Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
While everybody's trying so hard to please Him, I was made pleasing.
Amen.
And I'm excited about that. That's what I worship about.
Yes.
I was made except I have no fear. In love, there is no fear. Perfect love drives out all fear. Those who are afraid and live in fear, their love hasn't been made perfect. They don't know who Papa is. They've not been willing to dwell and believe in what He said and what He did. They're still trying to be somebody. When I came to California, I was actually invited to go up to the Bay Area to be with very wealthy people who were going to give their finances to promoting the music that I was doing and putting me on a very famous label. I stayed at the crossroads of my life saying, as a 19-year-old kid, I can go do this. And I just stopped off in San Diego, just as I was stopping off to surf. Surf with some friends who were out here who ran the Western Surfing Association. And the Lord said, what do you want to do? I said, I want you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I just became disinterested. It's like I became disinterested. It's like I just put it on the shelf. The wealthy people up there, I remember the people's names, all the stuff. It was there because it was a crossroads of my life. It was a moment in time. They would do it. They had the finances to do it. It was all about marketing. It was all about connections. I had spent about 5 years of my life with very good, excellent musicians. And the enemy had set to make my life something different than God had designed. I just found myself saying, Lord, my tongue is a pen of a ready writer. You know, I found myself some years after that decision in a place where what I was doing, nobody appreciated, nobody valued it. Everybody had their comments because I was living in a world that I really had given no development to, academics. I was living around people that's all they did all their life, spin the propeller. And, you know, there's certain times I think, you know, if I would have just gone there, I could have been doing all of this and had these kinds of responses. But something captivated me that didn't made all that was going on irrelevant. I was free to worship. I was living the life. Why? Because I had all the stuff. I didn't have nothing. Ann brought me food from University of San Diego cafeteria. Leftovers kind of thing. I mean, I was just like a starving student. You heard the starving students? Now the Lord took care of me. He used the angels came and the angel came and fed me. Somebody said to me some years later, I said, why didn't you tell anybody the situation you're in? I didn't need to. I was good. I had no complaint. I was good. I ate cactus apples at times. Anybody ever ate cactus apples? True. They're good. Just make sure you get rid of all the thorns. You got to pick a few thorns out of your lip and out of your tongue. But they're good. I was good. I wasn't thinking, I could be making a lot of money right now. I could be doing this and that and the other thing. Oh, you stupid person. I was good. I was free to worship, man. I was just, this is good. I got you, God. Amen. And it's getting better every day. Yes. I only started getting bogged down when I'm looking at people as a pastor that doesn't get it. I'm like, what? I got to hang with this. In other words, so you can learn humility. You can learn how to walk in brokenness. But Lord. I had a man of God come to me one time, and I was getting a little edgy. It's the early 90s. And he said to me, well, if the people of the Lord are going to walk in the wilderness, are you not going to walk with them to lead them into the right way? I said, no. Very loud. No. I'm done. And then, because we were eating, and then I continued eating, and then I started crying. Yeah, I will. And I just began to worship again. Because it's about Papa. Lord, my tongue is a pen of the ready writer. My tongue, it's your quill. The ink is you, Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Write the pages of your will. Write the pages of your life. Write the pages of your love.
Thank you, Lord.
It's inscribed upon my heart and displayed upon my face. Worship. I pray that you come into this life. That you quit wanting all the stuff that's temporal, that cannot satisfy, that perishes with the using. I pray that you'll get over trying to be somebody and needing the praises of men and being accomplished and have people tell you how good you're doing. Because if you need that, man, you got to get weaned to that first. Somebody said to me one time, they said, a preacher came to me just recently, he says, you know, he's laboring. He says, because he wanted to tell me he's never felt the presence and the power of God in his entire life like he experienced, except in Iowa. And he's trying to tell me, he said, he's saying, you know, I know that we got to be careful when we, you know, compliment people because it can go to their head. And he's trying to work through giving me, just tell me what happened to him when he got knocked out by God. I said, hold up, man. I said, I've been to the school of how to take compliments. He said, what school is that? Where everybody persecutes you and you're happy. Because when you're not going to get sad over the persecution,
amen,
you're not going to get all messed up over the praise. Because it all belongs in the same place. It's unto him.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I had a person write me this morning, a lawyer of a place that we went to. He said, let me tell you, the man you prayed for with cancer who had his intestines in a bag outside of his body is completely healed. We love you so much, kind of thing. You know, yeah, well, fine. And I know they mean that, but the bottom line of it is, yeah, Father can bring glory into our life and honor into our life, but humility goes first. And nobody likes the humbling process. Before there is honor, there is humility. You learn how to be broken. I want to learn. If there's anything that I'll pray, I woke up this morning saying, Lord, teach me. I'm just early in the morning. I'm like, Lord, teach me to walk in humility. Why? Because I've discovered it's the gold mine, man.
Yeah.
It's the gold mine.
Yes.
It's where all the riches are. teach me, Lord, how to walk in that
Lord.
Brokenness.
Yes.
But it's a humility and a brokenness that doesn't got us so sorrow, sackcloth, and sad. Those, all those S's belong with Satan. It's a joy.
Yes. Hallelujah.
It's a joy. Come learn of me.
Yes.
Come into the rest. Come learn of me.
Amen.
I'm meek and lowly.
Yes.
But in that meekness and lowliness, he had the oil of joy.
Woo.
That went beyond all others.
Thank you, Jesus.
With that love and joy comes an affection and a love for God that is only expressed by a love for God's people.
Yes.
And the only way you can love God's people is because you obey God and you have his love functioning and working in you. You know, John, I love how he does that. He comes at it from one angle, reverses it, and comes back at it from the other side. To where you can't lock it down. It's there because God's there. Really, it's rhetorical when we say, are you happy? Because we already know whether you are or not. You know what I'm saying? We usually say that because we're hoping to send spy or something. In your confession, because your pen is a, your tongue is a pen and ready to write, ready to write what God has said. If you're ready to write what God has said, if you're ready to speak what he's spoken, then he will speak through you things that go into a realm that none of us could think through or learn intellectually. He begins to explode the scriptures through our mouth and expressions. Oh Lord, my tongue is a pen, a pen of a ready writer. And I just want you to understand, for me, and what's going on here, and what I hope you understand what's going on, we didn't write this poem last night. This is the interpretation of the tongues that was happening on the platform. So, but we get themes from God, and we know what Father is saying. We know what he's expressing. And when Father speaks, it's not just for me. It's for everyone who will hear. He wants to do this in you. You could sit back and go, oh, I wish I had that. Don't do that. Say, thank you, Father, that you've done this in me too. And I want to learn to walk it. I want to learn to do it. I want to learn to live it. I'm going to learn to worship. I'm going to learn to move myself with your moving, with your movings. I'm going to learn to live under your inspirations. Because I'll tell you right now, you'll get so filled up and so overwhelmed and just so blessed by his divine expressions that you don't want to live without it. And then all of a sudden, some kind of sin or temptation or thing comes along that begins to mess with that, and you'll hate it because it's stealing from you the best. And that's how you learn to walk in righteousness, by the Holy Ghost, living and expressing his good stuff through you, not by all your rules and do's and don'ts and all your little religious things and notions, but by the expressions of the Holy Ghost. You get so overwhelmed with the goodness of his life, you don't want anything else. You don't want to be bogged down. You don't want to step over into the shadows. Not for a minute. You love, you are addicted to, dependent upon the effulgency of the brightness of his light. You know, we were singing a song on Wednesday night that the Lord also gave to us by tongues and interpretation of tongues. Let the sun shine, let the sun shine, let the sun shine. No more cloudy days. Let the sun shine like the brightness of noonday. Let the sun shine, the light of his life, the light of Christ Jesus. I'm living and dwelling in this life of Jesus. Whew. This is what Father's looking for. This is what the world is looking for. This is what the Haredim were looking for, the Orthodox Jews. The Lord said that the church would provoke them to jealousy because they would see the glory and the beauty and the splendor on us. Listen, you know what I'm laboring for? I'm laboring for a day when God's people are captivated by his presence, raptured in his glory, lit, and not just staying with just some one little expression, but then going from height to height, from glory to glory, where that there's the joy and the purity there at the same time, where there's the shouts and the prophecy there at the same time, where there's the expressions of God, the Holy Ghost, in every way, not just in one way, Am I thankful for one way? Am I thankful for every little person, get every little healing that takes place and the percentages? Am I thankful for somebody came to the meeting and smiled? Yes. Hallelujah. Am I thankful that somebody began to sing and it wasn't just a lip sync? It was a cry from their heart. You know, I love it when people got a voice and they begin to cry from their heart. It's beautiful. But you know, it's wonderful even when people don't have a voice. Huh? Like Geneva, and begins to cry out from her heart. Huh? Hallelujah. No, it doesn't bother her. That's the way I can say it. It's not meaningful to her. There's no meaning. Has no meaning. Her value is in another realm. It's not in herself. So I'm going to talk about people who are already there, who are there. They don't live off of a compliment or a complaint. That it, you know, an insult has no more difference to them than a compliment. It makes no more difference because it's another realm. That's why we can bless when we're persecuted. We can bless when we're cursed. We can love when we're hated. Because we've got something. We're in another realm. We have this divine expressions of the Holy Ghost. We're being led by the Holy Ghost. He leads us in the depths of our being. God made Adam a living being. And Jesus Christ became for us the reviving spirit. People want to dichotomize that and make that two different natures. That is so ridiculous. That is so far off from any reality. Somebody's trying to salve their iniquity. Somebody's trying to explain their inability to walk with God. That's all that is. It has no value in the scripture. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. That's what a reviving spirit is. A life-making spirit. Hallelujah. He wants to touch you today. You're here for God to touch you. You're here given an opportunity. You choose, though, what you would do with His Word, what you would do with Him, what you would do with what Father has said and spoken out of heaven, whether you're going to make God a liar or whether you're going to make God true. You choose. But this is how Jesus comes to you. John chapter 4, I'm going to read this to you, and then we're going to close. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you just worship. One friend of mine trying to just help people realize how stuck they are in religion said, yeah, I came in playing video games before I came to the meeting. I spent the whole afternoon playing some crazy video game that everybody was repulsed by. He knew how to worship. So there was the moving of God. Well, everybody else is fasting and praying, trying to get something. I received mine as a gift. When I fast and when I pray, and I'm going to do School of Spirit this week. I'm going to do it on fasting and praying. But when I fast and pray, I worship. I fast and pray in a different realm. I don't fast and pray to try to get God to do something for me. Huh? I fast and pray to learn how to be yielded and submitted to what He's doing. And all the time thankful for what He's done. Hallelujah. Just so blessed. Hey, man, God, you've done more with me than I could have ever thought or asked. I'll take Him, Christ Jesus, with rejection, with suffering, with persecution, with abandonment, with no money, with poverty, than I would the fame, the fortune, the red carpet, the gold record label, whatever this world could have possibly brought to me. Any day. One day the Lord was speaking to me about things that I could have done. I said, but Lord, I'm your boy. I don't want nothing else. I'm your boy. I don't need nothing else. I don't desire anything else. I'm just going to worship. That's a great time to worship.
Yes. Amen.
When do you worship? When everything's going your way? You just got a raise. Boss told you how wonderful you were. Huh? You got home. The house was cleaned. Huh? Everything's working. The dog listened to you when you said sit. All's going your way. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that breaks off the yokes, that removes mind-blinding spirits in the name of Jesus Christ. Every harassing, tormenting thing, every imprisoning thing, every self-seeking thing. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that every person in this place would be willing to take you rather than themselves. They'd rather have you than all that the world can supply. They'd rather have Jesus than anything this world could afford. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather have Jesus than riches untold. I probably reversed that, didn't I?
Yeah, silver and gold.
Silver and gold, whatever. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to me. And it's real. It's real to me. I'm here this morning for one reason. Because he's right the pages of his will upon my life. He writes the pages of his life upon my life. That's the only reason. I'm not doing my own will. I'm not doing my own thing. I'm not seeking my own life. And I won't. Because all I want is him. If he wants me to be in Timbuktu, in Kalamazoo, wherever. It's amazing when I've actually found out that Kalamazoo actually did exist. I was like, is that really? It's a place. Everybody's talking about going there. I mean, we need to go and have a meeting. Have a Holy Ghost meeting. Because I got him. Do we like to see people? Do we like to see people get touched by the power of God? We love to see people get healed. Oh, mama, say it to you. See people who are desperate. There is no hope. The guy that I was told about this morning that got healed of cancer, I was rough with him. I was rough with him because he needed to be rough with. He's playing games. He's just playing games. So I told him, you're playing games. Everybody's standing around trying to pat him on the back. But God loves you. No, you're playing games. I read in the Riot Act. Didn't I?
Yes, you did.
People were red-faced. Oh, my God. How can he talk to people like that? You have no idea. You don't know what's going on. You sit there and judge out of your own earthly existence, out of the framework of what you think is right and wrong. You need to get over here in a place where your tongue becomes a pen of a ready writer. You need to learn how to worship, then you can learn how to speak. Hallelujah. And it ain't about what you learned in your culture. It's about how the Holy Ghost, he takes over your emotions and he inspires. Rapatana Shipokana teaches you how to speak directly by him. And we watch this guy, man. We just watch this guy just get cut down to side by the Holy Ghost. He threw open his shirt and showed his intestines hanging out in a bag and his outside of his body, looking for sympathy. I said, I have none, but I do have the healing power of Jesus Christ. What are you going to do with your healing? What are you going to do with your miracle? Hallelujah. God is so good. His mercies endure forever. It had nothing to do with me. Jesus the healer was there. I just spoke the word. He's going to speak the word, he'll heal. It confirmed his word with signs and wonders. Hallelujah. People, come on now. Come on and worship. There's times, I mean, listen, I don't know. It's not like some forming, people won't form it. There's times I've taken people, never seen them in my life, just hold them to my chest. Just stand there and hold them to my chest. Just hold them there. Just overwhelmed with the love of God. Just overwhelmed, just not even say nothing. Just stand there and hold them. And miracles come and they get healed. It's Jesus. All I'm doing is cooperating with him. If he's hollering, I'm hollering. If he's holding still, I'm holding still. Huh? The one big thing that sometimes I get a little bit, you know, I have to hold back a little bit on is when the Lord's got me ready to kiss some woman on the forehead because nobody's going to understand. It's true because he does that and it's pure and it's holy and there's nothing evil in it. If you don't understand, because they're just minds in the gutter. Minds in the gutter. They're always second guessing that somehow you're doing something wrong. They need to worship. They need to recognize the flow of heaven and love. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes, I mean, there was not too long ago, there's this big old huge guy standing in front of me crying. And no, I knew I was supposed to kiss him on the cheek. Big old guy. Big, huge guy. I reached out and grabbed his neck, brought him down. He was more shocked, I think. No, he was caught away. He was sobbing. He was busted because the Lord set him free. The Lord delivered the guy. Person that you could see is a businessman, wealthy person of means. But he was getting stripped down to reality by the Spirit of the Lord. Hey, huh? God is so good. It's Jesus. It's the Holy Ghost. It's us just learning how to move with him. Worship. Worship. You need to learn to thank him for his goodness. John chapter 4. In verse 4, Jesus said, I have to go to Samaria. Then they came to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to a parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, being wearied of his journey, sat down at the well, and it was about the sixth hour, right around noon. Then comes a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me to drink. The holy man is saying something he's never supposed to do, communicate with the Gentiles. And then ask her to give him a drink, because their tradition means that you're communing with them now. For them to serve you, give me the drink. Listen to the master. That was the absolute opposite of everything that any religious person of his day would have ever thought of doing. A Samaritan, someone who does not know God, a Gentile, one who's unclean, asked them to give you something that is so necessary to serve you. Something makes you as unclean as they are. It's worse than touching them. Here he is. Are you telling, what are you saying, Pops? What are you, Lord, are you asking me for a drink? Are you asking for me something that makes glad the city of God? Are you asking for me something that belongs to the realms of your life that satisfies your being? Yes, I am, says the Lord. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman from Samaria said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, would ask a drink from me? A woman of Samaria, because you Jews have no dealings or association with us at all. Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew about the gift of God, and if you understood who's talking to you and saying, give me a drink, you would ask of him, me, and he would give you living water. Father's looking for a relationship. He's looking for somebody who's going to worship. He's going to look for somebody who delights to be with him.
who wants to know him, who's into something that goes beyond anything you've learned in the realms of men and everything that is earthly. He's giving you an opportunity, as he has given to all men. It's a leveling floor. There's no rich, there's no poor. There's no great, there's no small. Everyone is equal. God says, I'll give you an opportunity to be liberated. I'll set you free so that you can worship. So that you can give me a drink. Could you imagine giving the master a drink? Could you imagine ministering unto him of your substance, of your life, saying, sit here, comfort ye, you souls, while I get Anne to go make some food. Get busy, woman. Servants killed by the calf. Bring some water that I may wash your feet. Sit here in my best seat. Worship. That's what worship is. That's what Abraham was doing. He was worshiping. Worship. What will you do with Jesus? Is he still going to continue to be a religious person to you? A religious ideology? A dogma, something you can argue about, something you say you have that no one else has, and whatever it is, what goes on in the circles of humanity? Or will you come and begin to have a relationship of intimate, the most intimate type and kind? The woman said unto him, sir, you don't have anything to draw with, and the well is deep. How are you going to give me the living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank of it himself along with his children and his cattle? Jesus said, whoever drinks the water, this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I will give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be a well of water, an artesian, springing up unto the life of God, an eternal life, an unending, undiminishing life that's just always there. The woman said, sir, I'll take this water. Give me the water so that I never thirst nor come here ever again. Jesus said, go call your husband now and come with him. Now you're going to drink. You got to come clean. Now you're ready? Now you're ready? You want to begin to interact with me? You want to be able to give me a drink? Because that's what Jesus was asking for. He wasn't asking for water from the well. Of the earth that Jacob dug. He was asking for the water that would come from her, out of her innermost being, once she received this wellspring of life. But it's got to be pure, and you got to come clean with God. She said, I have no husband. Jesus said, yep, you're right. You've spoken the truth. The one that you now have is not your husband. The one you're now living with is not your husband. And this you've truly spoken. Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. You say that in Jerusalem is a place where men ought to worship. Now she's going to get to the heart of the matter, because now we're talking intimacy. Now God's talking to her heart, and now her heart's exposed. And now she's going to talk about what's intimate, what's real, what's true. Worship. See? Yes. See it? Yes. See, now that you're causing me to confront my deepest, darkest secrets, now that you've exposed the sin and the wrongdoing that is going on in my life, let's talk about worship. So many people want to try to worship God with all that stuff continuing on. They're not transparent. They've not come clean.
This is so powerful what Jesus said. He said, you've had five husbands. The one that you have right now is not your husband. He lays it out there. You've had five husbands. Woman, you messed up. I mean, it's one thing to have five husbands now. In the immoral, lascivious world that we now live in, then it was just, you were just totally an outcast. You were just totally twisted, totally messed up. You were the epitome of dysfunctional and wicked. Woman, you've had five husbands. Jesus said to her, listen to what he says to her. So powerful. Look at who God is looking for something from. Look at who he's going to make right so that she can supply that which satisfies his soul. He says one of the most powerful and gripping statements that rings out right now to you. Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know, for salvation belongs to the Jews. You can only worship when you're saved, when you're redeemed, when you're made right, when you're made righteous. Nobody can worship until there's redemption. You have to be made right first. You can't worship till you're made right. So many people don't worship because they're not made right. They've not come clean. There's been no redemption. There's been no justification. There's still condemnation. There's still separation. There's still a sense of distance. But the hour comes, and now is, when the true worshiper will worship the Father in the Holy Ghost, in spirit. Why? Because Jesus is the reviving spirit. He's the one who makes alive our spirit. He's the one who raises us up unto life where we were dead in our trespasses and sins, having redeemed us from all sin and iniquity, who brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light, that we may now show forth the praises of the living God. You, having been made right, having a conscience void of offense, having therefore no more condemnation, we can worship. Oh, this intimacy, this oneness, this thanksgiving, this praise. Oh, thank you for what you've done. A wellspring springing up inside of me in adoration of the King of Kings, the Lord of glory. My tongue is a pen of a ready writer. My tongue is his quill. The Spirit is the ink. Write the pages of your will. Write the pages of your life. Write the pages of your love. Written upon the tables of my heart and expressed upon my face. For the Father is seeking like we're supposed to seek. Seeking us like we're supposed to seek. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For they that come to God must believe that he is, that he exists, and that he's here, and that he's a rewarder of those who earnestly and diligently seek him. Seek the Lord. Seek him while he may be found. The Lord said, seek my face. And my heart said, thy face shall I seek. God turns it around and says, I'm seeking a drink. I'm seeking true worship. I'm seeking those who've been redeemed, who've been saved, who've been delivered from darkness. I'm seeking for those who will absolutely come over and step into this place of my life and begin to interact and joy and rejoice with me, because he's the God who rejoices over us and dances in the round dance and writes, as it were, songs of us, Zephaniah 3:17. When I first discovered it as a young, I'm still a young man, only 57 years old, but as a real young man, that he rejoiced over me, I'm like, wow, Come on. Woo. Zephaniah 3:17 has been with me since the very beginning of my walk with God. I'm dancing with him. I'm worshiping with him. Come on. This is the life. This is where all the blessings of heaven begin to flow. This is where you begin to realize what God said in his word. I blessed you with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. You seated together with me in the heavenly realm. This is where it all comes to bear, where you and I begin to tap in to all that which God so freely and richly and abundantly supplies to us. Freely, all things. Worship. 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 If Israel would have been willing to worship, they'd have been into their inheritance in 3 months instead of after 40 years. You choose. Which route are you on? Murmuring, complaining route, 40 years and you won't get there. Always in doubt, always frustrated, always wondering why. Oh God, where are you? What's wrong with me? Is what is wrong with you. I've come to deliver you. I've come to give you my life. When you embrace his life, I'm done. You move, I'm telling you. You no longer live. You don't count no more. It's no longer all about me. Wow. I love it. Free to worship. Stand with me. Hallelujah. Come on, name. What do I do when I'm overwhelmed? What do I do when my heart is overwhelmed? That's right. I asked Crystal, let me ask you, what do I do when my heart is overwhelmed? Only just a couple of you understand. What do I do when my heart is overwhelmed? Lead me. Very important word. Lead me to the rock. Huh? That dynamic gets worked out in our life, son. The Lord sees whether or not we want to be led. It's already, he sees that. It's already established. Because we've gone through the situations. We've gone through the turmoil. We've gone through the adversity. We've gone through the challenges. And we're always, lead me to the rock. Whoo, which is higher than. And what am I going to get when I get to the rock? Huh? What am I going to get when I get to the rock? I'm going to get a drink. What's coming out the rock? What's coming? What's going to happen when I get to the rock? I'm going to get a drink. When you drink, what's going to happen? A wellspring's going to spring. I tell you right now. A wellspring will spring. Well, if you could just learn to worship. Do I have times where I'm overwhelmed? Yes. Do I have times when there's challenges where I feel like, how can this go on? Yes. But what I do that's different than others is I get out of that real quick and I go to worshiping. I goes just saying, Lord, I got you. Thank you so much. Lord, I thank you for your life and your goodness. There are streams that I have, that you have, that make glad the city of God. Can you imagine that? That I can bring joy to his heart by worship. I wash his feet by worship. I give him to drink by worship. I give him to drink. Just so real, just so deep, just so intimate. Not for entertainment purposes. Not for copyright. Yes. It's the right to copy if you need. Huh? But it should be for inspiration right. Huh? Yes. Isn't that be great? This is so that you can write your own songs. This is so you can take a drink. Oh, Mama Nea. I tell you, where this river flows, the trees of life are growing like a forest on both sides of the stream. Take a leaf if you're sick and diseased and have yourself a bite to eat. For a matter of fruit, you won't get old. It won't get old. It won't get old. I can't even imagine. There were some people from the rainforest telling me, you don't understand, when you get back in the deep darkest part of the Brazilian rainforest, there's food that nobody knows about. It can't even be described. The taste is so different from anything else. It is so amazing. I'm thinking, tree of life. It's going to be good. Can you imagine? what it's going to be like, because I can just, God is so good and so creative and so amazingly creative. I bet it's 12 manner of fruit on every tree different. Hey? Hey? God wants to produce something in you that is a sound of heaven. God wants to produce something in you that only He has. A realm of the Holy Ghost, a realm of truth, a realm of the purity, a realm of the Spirit, a realm of the heaven, a realm of the supernatural, a realm of His glory that only He can supply. It's different from what men bring with their tambourines and with their flutes and with their instruments and with their voices and with their songs and with their rhymes. His tongue, it's a tongue, pen of a ready writer. My tongue, it is your quill. The ink is the Holy Spirit. Write the pages of your will. Write the pages of your life. Write the pages, oh God, of your love. Written upon my heart, expressed upon my face. Today, if you've never encountered Jesus Christ of Nazareth, somehow you've grown weary with your encounter. It was only an expression that you had the wrong one, or you got just somehow distracted. Because when you look on His face, it's a new kind of thrill every day. It's another dimension of an amazement revelation. It causes you to shout and scream with excitement, like the seraphims is shouting and screaming continually. God's calling you. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're the religious person who's always done everything. Oh, you look good on the outside. You got all the right prayers. You got, because reality of it is Jesus couldn't even connect with the people who had all the outward appearance, who had all the right prayers, who had all the right devotions. He couldn't even connect with them. He said there were many lepers in Israel, but He couldn't even connect with them in the days of Elijah. And a man of the heathen, a man who knew nothing about God, captain of the Syrian army, gets healed. There are many poor women hungry and starving in the days of Elijah, but He sent him to a woman of Samaria, Syrophoenician. Syrian, actually. Jesus said, I've got to go to Samaria because there's a woman there I can connect with. There's a woman there that's hungry. There's a woman there that's thirsty. She saw it all of her lifetime. She's just as bad off as the woman who spent all of her money on physicians and yet grew the worse. God is calling you today and He's asking you for a drink. God's asking you for a drink. But you've got to get right with them to be able to give it. You've got to confront the wrongdoing and the lies that are in your life and step into a redemption that only He can supply, a new creation that He gives. Then you can worship. Then you can worship. Then it won't be something that's just, you know, the prayer book that you're just reciting. It's the wellspring of your heart. Sing a new song unto the Lord. Hallelujah. God is calling you. Whether you're here in this place right now, or you're online watching on the web, or perhaps you're watching on a YouTube right now, the power of God has come to you. Christ Jesus stands before you. So all you've got to do is recognize who I am. There's some of you, you're trapped in religious ideology, and all you want to do is talk about what's wrong. God wants to show you what's right and make your heart right to begin with. He stands at the door. For some of you, He stands at the door knocking. And He says, open up your heart, and I will come in. And I will fellowship with you. That is an explosion. When God steps in, He says, behold, I stand at the door of your heart banging. He said, yeah. He says, yeah, I recognize that you're lukewarm. Yeah, I recognize that you don't get it. You think you got it and you don't have anything. You blind, wretched, miserable, naked, you don't have anything. You think you got it, but you've got nothing. But he's still there knocking. Behold, look and see, I stand at the door of your heart knocking. If any man, doesn't matter what kind of man, if any man will open up the door, just bring her here, I want to pray for her. I want to pray for her till, just stand with her. Stand there with her. And pray for her till she gets a breakthrough. She's only 2 years old, but I'll tell you right now, she's going to be a Holy Ghost two-year-old. Holy Ghost-filled two-year-old. Anyone? You'll open up the door to Jesus? Anyone? You'll respond to him and say, I'm amazed that you want to drink from me. And let him help you come clean. Let him show you where you've got to come clean. Whew. Let him bring redemption into your life, because you can't worship until you redeem, until you made right. And then I'm telling you right now, you'll get yourself a Holy Ghost dance. You'll get yourself a Holy Ghost shout. Oh, Sapatadea. Anyone right now, in this place, I want you to come right now. I want you to come right now. Anyone, Jesus is calling you. He loves you so much. He wants to change your life, and he's going to confront your life. And think, yes, you're going to have to change. But he'll bring the change. Anyone watching by web right now, there's no distance here. Christ Jesus is right there where you're at right now. He wants to change everything about your life. He wants to make a new creation. He wants to bring love. He wants to bring life. He wants to fill you with good things. Hallelujah. He wants to put joy in your heart and a smile on your face. Hallelujah. He wants you to know that you have a place with him in his kingdom now and throughout the ages to come. I'm telling you right now, when people respond to God, when people respond to God, it is such a big deal to God that all the angels of heaven know it. They just absolutely go wild. They go wild with excitement. They go wild with joy. They go wild with expression. Hallelujah. God is an amazing God, and he loves you so much. Today, let this be the first day of life for you. Not religion, the first day of life for you and freedom. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I take authority over every mind-blinding spirit and everything that has tried to trip you up and stop you and hinder you and hold you back. And I command in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that it leave you alone from this day forward. The power of God has come to you. The riches of God is supplied to you. Everything that he ever promised anyone, he promises it to you right now. All you've got to do is be willing to hear his voice, hearken unto him, turn from your sin, turn from the things that are wrong in your life, and let him live today. I'm gonna come and lay hands on everyone standing here. I just want you to close your eyes, lift your hands towards heaven in a place, in a posture before the Lord. Just say, I surrender to you. Because I'm gonna tell you right now, it's got to get intimate. It's got to get real. It's got to move beyond your self-conscious realm. Because if it won't, if it doesn't, not a lot's gonna happen. You're gonna have to surrender your heart. God's not gonna make you. He's not gonna force you. He's asking for you. He's asking for a drink from you. And it's a light that only he can supply to you. It's a praise. It's a worship. It's a joy. It's a fellowship. It's an intimacy. Write down the name of Jesus. Write down the name of Jesus. God creates a new beginning for you. Write down Jesus' name. What's your name?
Evan.
Let Jesus... Have you ever called upon the name of the Lord before? You called upon the name of Jesus before in your life?
Yeah, like a few times.
Yeah. What's going to make this different?
I don't know, because it's just hard for me to accept that these miraculous things are going to happen, because I do things so much on logic.
Okay.
So I just don't know what to do, because...
Well, logic is very limited.
True, but...
It's very limited for all men. You know what God will do for you in His love and His kindness and His mercy?
Anything.
He'll show you His love. So don't just receive right now. It's not about what you know. It's about, it's right here. He wants to kiss us. Not all the information. The greatest wisdom of men is foolishness to God. Give men enough time and he'll figure out that what God said is true. In the investigation of truth. But men don't have that much time. Our life is very short. Evan, in the name of Jesus Christ, this day, I prophesy an encounter of God in your life. And with a simple request of your heart, where you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, say, Lord, I'm done with my life. I want to live the life that you alone give, the life, your life. I want to understand what it really means to be a human being, what it really means to be alive in you. And Father has promised to do for you, Evan, just what he's done for everybody else who's called upon his name. Bring forth a new heart and a new spirit. A new creation. Different from what you were when you were born of your parents. And what you've been up to this time. Creates you anew. In the name of Jesus Christ. Take hold of the blood of Jesus Christ, which washes from, cleanses from all sin. Hallelujah. And be free. I bless you right now in Jesus' name. I set you free, Evan, right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I set you free right now. Jesus' name. Everything becomes new. Now in Jesus' name. Every fear, every anxiety, every torment of life goes from you. Now. Free to know him. Freed. Freed. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Thank you, Jesus. Say, Jesus. Say, Jesus. You're my Lord. I surrender my life to you. I'm washed in your blood. I'm made new by your Spirit. Set her down on the ground. Touch baby right now, Lord Jesus. Put your hands towards heaven, sweetheart. Touch baby right now, Jesus. ¿Cómo se llama?
Juliana.
Ah, I remember you. Baby, I pray for baby.
Dana.
¿Se habló inglés? No. Is someone translating right now? Okay, very good. Right now, they're translating. Very good. Let Jesus fill you. Where are you from? Escondido?
Escondido.
Jesus. Jesus said, whoever I set free is truly free. Whoever I liberate is truly liberated. So right now, in the name of Jesus, step into that freedom. Step into that liberty. Slit your hands towards heaven and just be filled with the Holy Ghost. Genela con Spirito Santo ora mismo. Genela con Spirito Santo. Genela. Jesus. For our God comes on you right now. Fuego de Dios. Fuego de Dios. Fire God comes on you right now. I prasa tarana de neke shilia tarama no seprete. Urasa te beke nestia. Molasta predena. I command a blessing on you right now in Jesus' name. I put a blessing on you right now in the name of Jesus. I bless you right now in Jesus' name. I bless you. With the ability to know Him. I give you my peace right now. I give you my joy right now, says the Lord. Everything becomes new. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, receive the life of God. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, as you've responded to God, He responds to you. I promise you right now, as you've responded to God, He responds to you. So let the life of God flow right into you. Let the life and the presence of Jesus flow right into you right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for a new beginning. This is a new beginning for you. Because I know that you've called upon the name of the Lord in times past. I know that there's been places in your life where you've walked with Him. But this is a day of new beginning for you. This is a day to be completely right with Him, filled with His Spirit and His presence. No more compromises. No more compromises. This is a new beginning for you. Thank you, Jesus. Fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of His presence. I call the fire of heaven down upon your life. The outpouring of the Spirit of the Lord to your life. Ha. You see, the power to know Him, to walk with Him. The wellspring spring from your life. And rivers pour out. Rio de Dios. Hallelujah. Fire God. Just receive. It's not hard. Just receive. Just receive. Receive. Receive right now. Receive right now. In the name of Jesus. Receive right now. All doubt, all unbelief, fades away. And just look at Him. Enjoy Him. Praise Him. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. This old affliction and torment that has harassed you In the name of Jesus. It goes, leaves you alone. In Jesus' name. Let the wellspring spring. Let the rivers flow. Let the life of God overwhelm you now. Just receive what He supplies. Just receive what He supplies. Just receive. Lord, take hold of my little brother right now. Right out of your belly, right out of your innermost being, I command in the name of Jesus Christ from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, everything about your life, completely surrender to Jesus. Heaven. Heaven now. Heaven now. The flow of heaven now. Jesus. Worship. 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 Jesus. Worship. Don't hold anything back. Don't withhold. Just worship Him. Too many times people want to second guess God and try to make sure that they're all right. God's made you right. Start praising Him. Jesus. Father, I thank you for putting your blessing upon blessing.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I speak revelation, understanding, knowledge in your spirit. The revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ, the knowledge of the Lord, the understanding of the things of the Spirit. Now in Jesus' name, everything that has harassed and tormented your mind, I break the power off of it. I break the power of it off of you now. I break the authority of it off of you now. Let the wellspring spring. Let the river flow. Let the praises begin. Now, in Jesus' name. Let the high praises be in your mouth and the sharp two-edged sword in your hand. Zadara days to be received. Just begin to thank Him for His so great a salvation. Begin to thank Him that you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Begin to worship and praise Him for this cleansing that Calvary supplied, that He supplied when He hung upon a cross. That's what we mean by Calvary. This wonderful salvation. Monzembrande. Just lift your hands. Zombrenano. Mayananane. Mayanana Manasa. Just worship Him. Just worship Him. Worship Him. Just worship Him. Just worship Him. Worship Him. There's a river. There's a river that you can have. There's a river that you can have. There's a river that you can have. There is a river you can have. There is a river you can have. There is a river you can have. There's 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 a river you can have. Just let him feel you. Let him touch you deep into your life. Let him touch you deep into your emotions. Let him overwhelm you with his peace. Wherever his blood is received to cleanse and wash from sin, his peace enters in. His life comes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your anointing. Thank you, Jesus, for your rivers. Thank you, Father, for your promises. Thank you, Father, for your word. Lord, your word framed the ages, created the heavens and the earth. And I thank you, Lord, that your word formed me. Just tell him. And thank you, Father, that your word brought forth in me all your promises. Jesus. Everybody stand with us. Will you just stand? If you're on the ground, you stay on the ground. If God put you down, stay there. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just lift them up towards heaven. Hallelujah. Ears to hear, eyes to see, understanding heart. Papa gives you ears to hear. Blessing. Papa gives you ears to hear spiritual things. Eyes to see. And a heart to understand. That's what he gives. That's what he gives to you, Evan. That's what he gives. That's what he gives to those who just stay around long enough to hear his voice. Give you eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We'll just come worship the Lord with your giving. Just worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offering. Just stay in worship. Don't get distracted. Stay in worship. Find people around you that are not caught away in heaven, if you want. Hug them and tell them that you love them. But be careful. Don't disturb anyone who's worshiping the Lord. Evan, the Lord gives you eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand. It's Evan, right? Gives you eyes to see. That's what conversion does. That's what salvation deliverance does. Israel would not hear, so that because they would not listen, they would not hear, and they refused. They had eyes that could not see, and ears that could not hear, and a heart that could not understand. But God, through his mercy and his love, anyone who asks, he gives them eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand. Father gives that to you. It's yours. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bethany. Okay. Block, well, I've commanded to leave you right now. Anybody in this place, if you have any, anybody's dealing with a headache, if there's anybody got any pain in their body at all, any sickness or disease in your body at all, we're here to pray with you and for you. Someone with pain in their right knee, did you say right knee?
Left knee.
Left knee. Somebody's got pain in your left knee, be healed right now. If the Lord's going to call it out, just be healed right now. If you have pain in your left knee, just be healed right now. If you have a headache, be healed right now. Right now in the name of Jesus, just receive your healing. Just receive right now. Just receive it. Just receive it. Many times the word of knowledge is just like, it's just like laying hands on a person. If the word comes and heals you, it's supposed to set you free and deliver you. You got a headache? Be healed right now. You got a pain in your left knee? Be healed right now. You got any kind of sickness and disease that we haven't called out specifically? You want us to lay hands on you and pray for you? Come and we'll do that. And the Lord will heal you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Find a bunch of people around you. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. Hallelujah. Once again, don't disturb anybody who's on the floor, anybody who's worshiping, anybody who's praising God. What's up? What's happening with you? What do you need? Well, just lift your hands towards heaven. What kind of pain? Oh, soreness pain. Bless your heart. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened right now. Barasa de dekin in Mashiach. Barasa to the Niniki andolo la masarra de mekia la masista. Rabra de kiandolo la batambra de vesti siatolo la masifi. Salambra de test. Just let Jesus touch you now if you have any needs. Anybody standing in here with any kind of need in your life? Just let Jesus touch you now. He loves you so dearly. Doesn't want anybody leaving here hurting, in pain, distraught, tormented in any way. Just receive in Jesus right now.